Ladies and gentlemen, would you greet the Jackson Five?
Hi, my name's Aaron. Good to be here with y'all. Okay, a little bit about me. I have been working or serving in North Coast for about 3 years now, and I volunteered my time as an intern here in 910 just like two and a half years ago, which is crazy. Okay, and then what's even more funny is that I went to go work for Hayden, your new pastor, okay, over in Carlsbad. And I was over there for about a year and a half, 2 years. And then I transitioned over here to 1112. And Hayden just missed me so much that he followed me out here to 910. That's totally the reason he came. Okay, don't tell him I said that. All right, and so it's an honor to be here with y'all. You guys have been in a series called the ABCs, which stands for a biblical context, right? And we're talking about the relationships in your life. I believe that I'm closing it out. Do I know? No, I don't. Okay, I am closing out. Yay. So this is the last ABCs that you will be a part of, unless you're a freshman, then you could have it again. You look mad about that. You look really upset. Okay. So we're going to be talking about something that we all struggle with. Okay. Something that's prevalent in all of our lives. And I want to start it with a story. See, last October, okay, I was in a car with a group of friends and we were kind of caravanning, right? Anybody like to road trip? Anybody? Okay. Road tripping is fun until you get to the point where you're like, get me out of the car. Like, please get me out of the car, right? And we were going up to Big Sur. Anybody ever been up to Big Sur? Few people. Okay, if you've never been up to Big Sur, it is, if you just follow the coast of California all the way up, you pass Morro Bay, and you don't quite get to San Francisco, you will be in what's called Big Sur. Okay, and Big Sur is a beautiful landscape. It's coastal, like I said. It's just gorgeous. Like, it's one of those areas in California that just haven't been touched by all of the building and all of the civilization, right? And we were going up there for a wedding, okay? And it was one of my closest friends' wedding. His name is Jojo. Maybe you've heard of Jojo, okay? Maybe Jojo's been here, right? And we were driving up there, and we got up there on a Friday night. Their wedding was on a Saturday. We went to In-N-Out. I started getting sick. It's not part of the story, okay? It was one of those days that you walk in, you're like, it's coming. I'm about to get sick, right? And so I woke up the next morning, not getting up because I was sick, but the wedding was that day, and we were getting ready to celebrate them, okay? So I, like, was on every type of medication that I could have possibly been on. I don't know why I'm continuing this part, because it's not part of the story, okay? I was sick, the end. But we were getting ready to celebrate their wedding, right? And the night before we went to In-N-Out, we went to go check out their wedding location, where they were going to do the ceremony, okay? And it was on this beach, and it was this beautiful place. There was, like, caves out in the water, and it was gorgeous. I mean, if you sat on this beach, you could literally sit there all day, and you wouldn't be able to take in what you were looking at. It was one of those things, you know? And we checked it out. There was plenty of parking. There was, you know, yeah, a cool walk to the beach. You had it all, right? This was, like, the perfect spot. And they'd planned this forever. They'd been planning this spot for almost a year now. And Saturday came, we got up, we got dressed, we did the photo shoot. They did their vows, their first look, right? And we're driving to this beach spot. And as we make the turn into what would have been the parking lot, we get stopped by a park ranger. Hey, this guy, I'm not going to say he had a punchable face, but he did, okay? And he stops us, right? He's like, roll down the window. And we're like, what are you about to say to us right now? Okay. And I just want you to be aware. Okay. It's our car. I was driving with Brennan. You might've heard of Brennan. Yeah. You should have heard of Brennan. Okay. And you're like, might've. I see him every week. Okay. And then behind us was the bride and the groom. Okay. So the park ranger stops us. He says, roll down your window. So we roll down our window and he's like, hi, I can't let you guys through. We're like, why not? Like, we're just going to the park. There's a wedding that's going on. Like, we need to get down there. And he's like, I can't let you through. The parking lot's full. I was like, okay, well, what if we drop everybody off and then we just have a couple drivers that, you know, go park somewhere else and they can walk? No, I can't let you drop anybody off. Why? because there's only one way in and one way out of this park. And if there's a fire and anything happens, we can't have more people than who could get in a car. And I'm thinking, we're on a beach. The fire's not going to get you in the ocean. Like, we could just jump in the ocean, right? And he, like, would not let us through. And so we're going, hey, you just don't understand. Like, we drove up from San Diego, and we have a wedding that's going on here. And he says, I kid you not. He looked at us, and he goes, it was a stupid idea to plan a wedding here. Yeah. That's what he said. And I'm like, okay, I'm sick, right? But I'm in the passenger seat, and Brennan is to my left, right? And we were both like, there was steam coming out of our ears, right? And behind us, all I'm thinking is like, the bride and groom are behind us. We're going to have to get out of this, and they're going to pull in and be like, hey, why can't we go in? And this idiot is going to say, it was a stupid idea to plan a wedding here. And all hell is going to break loose, right? And so we were just fuming. And you wouldn't believe it. The clouds just rolled over this car, and lightning struck this dude. And you should have seen the dumb look on his face. Okay, that didn't happen. But, right, we were so ready to hop out of this car and just give this guy the biggest knuckle sandwich he could have ever taken, right? We're like, you're a park ranger. What are you going to do? Arrest us? You can't, right? I'm going to drive right past you. And I just remember being so angry at this guy. And anger is something that you and I are going to experience now and for the rest of our life. See, if we look at the Bible in Ephesians 4, it actually says, be angry. You're like, wait a minute. It says, be angry and do not sin. See, you and I have been given the emotion of anger by God. Anger is not a mistake. We have been given anger. It is this emotion that has been given to us. Having anger is not the sin. It is what you do with your anger that can create sin. Having anger is not the sin. See, when we were sitting in this car and this guy said, it is a stupid idea to plan a wedding here, the anger that we felt, that was not the sin. If I had jumped out of the car and knocked this guy out, I think it could have been justified, right? But that would have been the sin. I want to define anger as this. Okay, I love that it's called anger in English because the ending is literally grr, right? Anger is like, it's that grr feeling that you're like, right? Anybody ever like text somebody and you're like, how do I describe my anger right now? And you just all caps grrrrrrrrr, grr. Okay, my sister and I used to do that all the time. It's the grr feeling. That's how we're going to describe it. And we all wrestle with it. So I want to talk today about what is a biblical response to our anger. Because if anger is a God-given emotion that all of us have, well, he said we can be angry, but we should not sin, right? So there is a way for us to be angry and to not sin. And so we're going to talk about a biblical approach to how we handle our anger. And we're going to end up with three different points, okay? Three different points. The first one is slow down. This is a biblical response to how we handle our anger. And the first point I'm just going to say is just slow down. See, here's our initial reaction. When the guy looked at me and he said, this is a stupid idea to plan a wedding here. I'm so smart, park ranger, right? And my initial reaction is, you're dumb. I'm driving past you. All my initial reactions were negative. Punch him in the face, drive past him, run him over with the car, like, I just anything to get past this guy, right? I was just heated in the moment. Have you ever, okay, this is like my favorite example of anger, is like if you've ever been at home and you know the dishes are just piling up in the sink, right? You see it and you're like, I'm just going to be such a good child this time and go clean them. You know, I mean, I deserve the parade afterward, but I'm just going to go clean them, right? And you're like in your room, you're like getting the, like, I don't know, the motivation to get up and go clean these dishes. And on your walk to go clean these dishes, your mom stops you and goes, hey, can you clean the dishes? And you're like, I don't want to do it anymore, right? Anybody? Okay. Right? We all live the same life, okay? And in that moment where you're like, mom, you don't even understand. I was on my way to do it. Like, I don't even want to do it anymore. Your initial reactions are anger, annoyance. I want to smart mouth my mom. I want to walk away and not do the dishes anymore, right? Our initial reaction is never the answer to our anger. our initial reaction can't be the answer to our anger because we're not thinking rationally. Okay, I don't remember who told me this, but I remember hearing it from somewhere. They said, Aaron, God has given us 2 ears and 1 mouth for a reason. You should listen twice before you ever speak once. I think that's good wisdom. Why? Because we should slow down. And here's what the Bible has to say about it, okay? In Proverbs 16:32, it says, whoever is slow to anger is better than the mighty. Okay, Proverbs 19:11 says, sensible people, people with good common sense, control their temper. And in James chapter 1, verse 19, it says, you must be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Why? James continues with, because our anger does not produce the righteousness of God. Our anger doesn't produce the righteousness of God. See, we should be slow. The first thing you should be thinking when you're angry, okay, has anybody ever heard of how to deal with your anger? And they're like, count to 10. I think that's so unrealistic because if I'm having a conversation with Ashley and Ashley says something that I don't like, and then I'm just like, 1, 2, 3, 4. Like, what am I doing in those 10 seconds? Am I just staring her down? Like, 1, 2, 3. Like, what do I do, right? But maybe you don't count to 10, but maybe we just take a breath. Right? We slow down. Let's be quick to listen out to why they're saying the thing that they're saying. Right? Let's not be people who jump in and give them our first harsh reaction. The knuckle sandwich that we think that they deserve, right? Or the harsh reaction, or, you know, the running over the guy with the car. None of those are a good option. But a good option is to slow down and to hear them out, to understand why they're saying what they're saying. Okay, my second point is this. My second point is this, and this is, I know this is going to be a little nerdy. It might be a little theologically heavy, but I think you guys are mature enough and at the age that you can handle this, okay? It's a big, broad topic, but the second reason, or the second way that we handle our anger is that we have to remember that the second point for how we handle our anger is that justice belongs to God. Justice belongs to God. Here's what I mean, okay? If we read a passage, it comes right out of Romans chapter 12. I'm going to read it for you. It's kind of long. Sorry. Here we go. It says, never pay back evil with more evil. Has that ever been something that you wanted to do? Has somebody ever said something behind your back and you're like, I don't understand how you could spread a rumor that's not true about me? Well, I'm going to get you back now, right? one of my favorite things about working with Hayden is that Hayden is the biggest prankster you'll ever meet in your life, okay? I have a vivid memory of working in an office with Hayden, and me and my coworker, Juliana, were like, how do we prank Hayden right now, right? It's a great thought. How do we prank Hayden? And we were sitting on these oak chairs, right? They were just like bright oak chairs on this big meeting table because we didn't have a meeting table in our own office at the time. And Hayden had gone out to go talk to somebody, and so we're sitting there. We're like, you know what he couldn't see on this chair is a bucket full of water. So what did we do? We poured an entire water bottle on this chair. Could he see the water? No, he couldn't. We were good, right? And so Hayden comes back in this meeting room, and he's like, oh, guys, I have the craziest story. Oh, right? He's still like right back up. His pants were soaked. It's like 12 o'clock. So he still has like 5 hours of working, right? And it was great. We pranked Hayden. The thing about pranks, though, is if you've ever done a prank, you know that if you get somebody, they have to get you back better than you got them. Hayden failed. He never got us back. Okay. But you know that when somebody makes you angry, our first reaction might be to get revenge, to get them back worse than they got us. Right? Somebody spread a rumor about us? Well, I'm going to go spread a harsher rumor about them. Somebody said something I didn't like? Well, I'm going to come back and give them a roast that they don't like either. Right? Our first reaction can often be to take revenge on somebody who's wronged us. And the reason that I point us back to justice belongs to God is because he says it right here. Never pay back evil with more evil. Matter of fact, he continues and he says, do all that you can to live in peace with everyone. Dear friends, never take revenge. leave that to the righteous anger of God. Okay, there's two different kinds of anger. There's our anger, which we learned in James does not produce the righteousness of God. And there's God's anger, which is perfectly righteous, perfectly just, perfectly loving. And so when you and I take off the pressure of having to take revenge on people, we leave it to God, who has perfect, righteous, loving anger, right? And it takes off the pressure of you having to get somebody back better than they got you. Because what has that ever done for you? It's left you feeling empty. It's left you feeling worse than you felt when they just roasted you, right? But we should aim to live in peace with everyone. And if we know that God's anger is righteous, we know that he's going to do what's right, right? We know that he's going to cover it fully. He's not going to miss anything. You and I don't have to get revenge, which is going to be incomplete. It's going to be lacking of substance. It's going to be temporary when God's revenge is eternal. We can trust in God's righteous justness, okay? And the last thing is this, and it comes out of story. Straight out of Genesis 4. If you have your Bibles, you can turn there. It's Genesis 4, okay? And we're going to read the whole thing. If you've heard of the creation, okay, you've heard of Adam and Eve, two individuals, right, who sinned because they ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, right? And then the world became full of sin and became full of darkness. Thanks, Adam and Eve, right? But we're all the same, so can't really blame them. But after Adam and Eve had the fall in the garden, they went on to have kids, right? Because God said, be fruitful and multiply. He said to go have kids, right? And so they have two sons. They have Cain and they have Abel. And we're going to read a story about Cain and Abel. In Genesis chapter 4, it says this. If you're there, say, I'm there.
Preach.
No, I'm not Braden. We can't do preach, okay? Okay, here we go. Genesis 4 verse 1 says, now Adam had sexual relations with his wife. Whoa, okay. Eve, and she became pregnant. When she gave birth to Cain, she said, with the Lord's help, I have produced a man. And later she gave birth to his brother and named him Abel. Okay, we have Cain and Abel. When they grew up, Abel became a shepherd while Cain cultivated the ground. When it was time for harvest, Cain presented some of his crops as a gift to the Lord. Okay, underline that, some of his crops as a gift to the Lord. And Abel also brought a gift, the best portions of the firstborn lambs of his flock. Okay, so we have a situation, right? We have Cain and we have Abel. And Abel became a shepherd, but Cain was a farmer, right? And when it came time for a harvest, Cain harvested some of his crops and he brought it to the Lord, right? While Abel brought his best firstborn lamb. Do we see the difference here? Okay, it's kind of like when we read a story later on in the Gospels, and are we good, gentlemen? Are we good back there? Are we all right? All right, thank you. It's kind of like later in the Gospels when we read that there was a rich man who gave three of his quarters versus the homeless woman who gave all that she had, right? And we see this where Cain gave some of the crops, where Abel gave his best firstborn sheep. We see a difference in the heart posture, right? Abel gave all that he had, and Cain gave some that he had to God. There's a difference. And we see in verse 4. The Lord accepted Abel and his gift, okay? The Lord accepted the firstborn lamb, but he did not accept Cain and his gift. He didn't accept the half-hearted crops that Cain gave him. And this made Cain very angry, underline that. And he looked dejected, right? He looked angry. He was in that grr stage. And in verse 6, it says, why are you so angry? The Lord asked Cain. Why do you look so dejected? You will be accepted if you do what is right. But if you refuse to do what is right, then watch out. Sin is crouching at the door, eager to control you. Okay, underline that. Sin is crouching at the door, eager to control you. But you must subdue it and be its master. And we learn later on in verse 8, it says, one day that Cain suggested to his brother, let us go out into the fields. And while they were in the fields, Cain attacked his brother Abel and killed him, right? Well, you've probably heard of this story before. If you've been in church any amount of time, you've heard of this Cain and Abel story. And so why am I here? Why did I resort to this passage? Well, if we can see, Cain gets very angry, right? And the Lord has a response to him that I want us to take away. See, the Lord says, why are you angry? Right? Why are you angry? And it says, if you do what is right, you will be accepted. But if you refuse to do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. See, the third point is this. We must surrender our anger quickly. Surrender our anger quickly. When you and I harbor our anger, right? Like Cain, we can see. Cain, when the Lord didn't accept his gift, had anger. And we read that when he went to go kill Abel, it was later on, right? It says one day. So it was a different day than the day that the Lord had said, I don't accept your gift. So we can see that Cain has been holding this anger in for a long time. And it resulted in a great sin. And so my encouragement to you, 910, is that as you walk through life, as you meet the park rangers that tell you something they should never say to your face, as you walk through high school and you have friends that say something they should have never said about you, as you have parents that say things or do things that make you angry, as you have older or younger siblings that treat you in a way that you shouldn't have been treated, and you become angry about this, my challenge is that you would surrender this anger quickly, because the risk is that sin is crouching at your door waiting to take control of you. When you and I don't surrender our anger quickly, when we don't release what is welled up inside of us, sin is waiting at your door, ready to pounce, right? The Bible describes sin, describes the enemy as a roaring lion, waiting for you to slip up, waiting for you to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. There's never been a moment in my life where I have been angry and held it in for a long time, and it's resulted in anything good, right? What I do, okay, this is kind of vulnerable. What I do when I become angry is I actually distance myself from people. I would rather not be near you. You said something I didn't like, I'm gonna move away from you. I don't wanna deal with it. The only problem with that is that love moves towards its object. So I'm doing the opposite of a loving thing. And sometimes when you and I harbor our anger, it comes out in lashing out at people. Because have you ever heard of somebody exploding, right? Have you ever held in something or swept it under the rug or acted like it never existed for long enough? And then somebody said something that wasn't even that big of a deal and you just, right? And you're like, oh, I don't know why I did that. Because you've been angry for so long. You've been holding it. You've been sweeping it under the rug. You've been acting like it doesn't exist. You've been trying to ignore it, but it's still there. You haven't forgotten about it. It's still with you. We have to be people who surrender our anger quickly, or else it's going to come out in an unloving way on people. And if we're going to strive to live in peace with everybody, we got to address our anger. And you might be asking, how do I surrender my anger, Aaron? How do I surrender it? Okay, here's my challenge for you. It is to separate yourself for a little bit, okay? And okay, I'll give you two options, because there's people like me who are the internal processors, and then there's people who are not like me who are the external processors, okay? God bless y'all. I don't know how you do it, okay? If you are an internal processor like me, I need time alone. I need time alone because I need to think about what the heck just happened, right? And so maybe it's going by myself on a walk. Maybe it's going in my room and putting on music and just thinking about what happened, right? Maybe, I don't know what it looks like for you. If you're an internal processor, all that means is I gotta think. I can't think out loud, right? I can't talk and feel my feelings. I have to go think about them, okay? Is that you get away and you think about what's happening. You understand why you're angry. You go address it. See, the thing that I don't want you to do if you're an internal processor is to separate yourself and then never address it. Go listen to, you know, watch YouTube or watch a Netflix show and be like, man, I'm not angry anymore. I don't want to think about it. If you are an internal processor, I challenge you to go think about it. Actually address the issue, right? If you're an external processor, find somebody that's willing to listen, one of your friends, family members, whatever, who isn't related to the issue, okay? If you're in an argument with your mom, don't go to your mom to externally process your feelings. not going to end well, right? Go find somebody who's neutral in this situation and in a loving way. And what do I mean by a loving way? I mean, you don't gossip about the person that you're angry with. You don't talk badly about them. You don't just go rant to somebody, okay? Because something that I have done, and I'm not an external processor, but when I go externally process, is let's say Ashley's just been the heel of all my examples today, right? Ashley says something I don't like. So then I come over here to Wyatt, and I'm like, Ashley, have you heard about Ashley? She did this. Now I feel better. Thanks, Wyatt. Did Wyatt say anything? No, right? And a better way would be for me to approach Wyatt and go, hey, Wyatt, I'm feeling angry about this. And I'm frustrated with Ashley, but can you help me maybe see a different perspective? Can you help me see something I wouldn't normally see because I'm stuck in my anger right now? Does that make sense? If you're an external processor, go find somebody who's neutral in the situation and in a loving way, seek to understand your anger. Don't seek to talk trash on somebody else or seek to gossip about somebody else or seek to throw somebody else under the bus. And if we surrender our anger, and another way, by the way, is to go and pray to God. I would actually do that first before you went to anybody, is to go pray to God. Go, God, I'm frustrated right now. I'm angry. Can you show me wisdom about why I'm frustrated? Can you give me understanding so that I can understand why I'm so angry at this person, right? Seek God, either go by yourself or go seek somebody else and lovingly find out why you're angry. This is how we handle our anger in relationships, okay? This is the ending of the ABCs. Just to reiterate the 3 points, slow down. Trust that God is handling, God, justice belongs to the Lord. That point is really hard for me, okay? And then surrender your anger quickly. Those are the 3 points. I'm gonna pray for y'all and then we can get on out of here. Heavenly Father, God, just thank you for every person in this room. Thank you for the ability to come in here and to learn your wisdom, God, because these aren't my words, these are your words. They come straight from your text, your Bible, God. I just pray that we can receive in our heart what you have for us, God, and then not just receive it in our brain, but then go live it out and become people of light, become people of love in this world, because the world loves to react on revenge and to treat each other poorly when we're angry, God, but you have called us to be in control of our anger, to surrender it to you, to still choose to live in peace with people who make us angry. So God, I just pray that that challenge can be on our hearts as we go live this out. We love you. We pray all these things in your name. Amen.